following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, it is. It is, and it's a Friday. Oh, we made it to a Friday. That's an accomplishment when we make it to the end of another week because, well, things are pretty much fucked. Right? It's one thing after another. But it is Friday and the weekend is here. And I'm excited that we have a great show planned today. You know, I have railed for a long time against... not against the Lincoln Project, because I like what they're doing. I appreciate the fact that they are, working with us to oust the orange idiot who's occupying the Oval Office. This is the worst travesty. It's the destruction of America. Not that we were great before, but certainly our standing in the world was better. Our if we had a president who knew what the hell he was doing, I really think the United States would be in line with the rest of the civilized world when it dealing with this coronavirus. Instead, we've reached just ridiculous benchmarks. We are the most infected nation on the planet. We have the most people dying from COVID-19 than any other country per capita on the planet. And it's because of the sheer incompetence at the top. Experience matters. This is what happens when you elect a reality TV show. I don't even want to call him a star because he's a TV creation. Everything about him is fake, including the idea that he was a good businessman. He was never a good businessman. And this is a guy who came into being his big selling point in the 2016 campaign was that he's the great negotiator. Really? Well, he hasn't even been present in these negotiations for the new round of COVID relief. He has not done a single thing. The negotiations are being carried out by Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer for the Democrats. And Mark Meadows, who's the chief of staff, who was, he was the head Tea Party guy. He was the head of the Freedom Caucus. And him and Steven Mnuchin, that's who the Republicans are putting. Not even Mitch McConnell, the Senate Majority Leader, is not participating. And the president, the great negotiator, isn't participating either. And, well, they reached a stalemate last night. The Senate and the House left. They're gone for the weekend. Or maybe longer because they are supposed to have their August recess. But we have millions of Americans out of work, unable to find employment because there are no jobs, because we are in the midst of a global pandemic. The extra money for unemployment compensation ran out last week. And Congress is doing nothing. I don't want to say Congress is doing nothing. The Republicans will not play ball. So I'll get to the news in just a moment. It's sickening, though. So today I'm going to make you feel a little better. Because as I started to say before, I have my issues with the Lincoln Project. Again, they do great work, but I can't help but remember who they are and know who these people were before Trump took office. And they wanted, quote, entitlement reform. They want to do away with Medicare and Social Security. They want to cut your benefits. They want to do away with the social safety net. And these are not, I hate the word entitlements, even though we are entitled to these things. And the reason we're entitled to them is because we paid into them our entire lives. So here I am. rapidly approaching 61 and, fighting against the clock to see, do I get Medicare or don't I? Do I get Social Security or don't I? Are they going to find a way to take it away from me? And make no mistake, Donald Trump is threatening that if they don't come to get come to some kind of arrangement, some kind of a deal, before, I guess, the end of the day today, that he's going to take executive action. One of the things he says he'll do is extend the moratorium on evictions. Good, because millions of people can't pay the rent, can't pay the mortgage, and we've cut off their extra assistance. And now there's going to be an even bigger homeless crisis than we already have. So Trump says he'll extend the moratorium. Good, do that. That would be a good thing. But then he says the other thing he'll do by executive order is a payroll tax cut. A payroll tax cut? First of all, that directly takes the money out of the Social Security Trust Fund and out of the money that goes for Medicare. And it does nothing to help the millions of people who are unemployed who aren't on any payroll. But again, this is what happens when you elect somebody who has no clue what they're doing to a job for which they are not qualified. But I keep digressing. I keep starting to talk about the Lincoln Project and I go off on Trump. The reason I'm talking about the Lincoln Project is, yes, they're creating some wonderful videos, some great ads explaining why you should not vote for that man. But they're not the only ones doing it. And there are a number of other producers on the interwebs who are doing equally good work and not getting as much recognition. And one of those groups is called MeidasTouch. And I was so impressed by their videos that I went to their website, and I should be eligible for Medicare. I'm not. I'm only 60. Diane Russell in the Facebook chat room, because we're still suspended from YouTube, which is a rough subject. Well, I'm working on it. That's all I can tell you. So I should be eligible for Medicare, but not for another 4 years and 3 months. 3 months, August, September, October, November 4th. So the day, hopefully, after the election, when we vote Donald Trump out of office, I will be 61. So not ready for Medicare yet. So thus, I depend on the Affordable Care Act. But again, I digress. So the MeidasTouch guys, I went to the website and I read up on them. And they're three brothers. Meiselas is their last name, which I guess is a play on Midas. So, but they do, everything they touch seems to turn to gold, because they've got a ton of viral videos that are really good, and they're prolific as hell. I mean, I posted one yesterday, and sure enough, it got retweeted hundreds of times. And then this morning I wake up and there's another new one from MeidasTouch that I tweeted out. So it's Don the Hoax, basically. Well, maybe, you know what? Here, let me play it for you. Is this it? That's not it. Here it is. Trump hoaxed. All right, here is the newest video from MeidasTouch.
So Obama's talking about all of this with the global warming and that, and a lot of it's a hoax. It's a hoax. I mean, it's a money-making industry, okay?
As global temperatures continue to rise, experts say humans will face
worse and worse heat waves and superstorms and floods and wildfires.
Thank you, everybody.
Now we're being hindered by the Russian hoax.
U.S. intelligence officials are warning of a new election interference threat coming from the same source as 2016, Russia.
This hoax should never happen to another president.
Now the Democrats are politicizing the coronavirus. And this is their new hoax.
As the pandemic ravages the U.S.,
more than 150,000 Americans have now died.
We've got a real problem, and it stems from the leadership.
And a lot of it's a hoax.
It's a hoax.
Sorry for all the audio dropouts. That's a problem sometimes when I play video here. It does that. But anyway, I'll fix it for the podcast. I'll fix it in post. So that's the newest video from MeidasTouch, Trump Hoaxed America. And the three Meiselas brothers, Ben, Brett, and Jordan, will be my guests today. So they're coming up in a little while. So I want to run through this. All right, it's Friday. You can tell I'm frustrated. Let's start with a funny. And this funny comes from someone who has only two videos on his YouTube account. The first one, I don't even know what it was, but it's not a parody song of any consequence. This is the only real thing on his YouTube channel. His name is Oscar Nowak, and he gives us the COVID mask. You wearing your mask? I hope so. Take it away, Oscar.
Calling all cars. Calling all cars. Man trying to enter an office building on 4th and Main with no mask. Repeat, no mask.
I walk into my job late last week when my co-workers all began to freak. They started cursing and began to shout and said quite rudely as the boss threw me out.
You need a mask.
I need a COVID mask.
A COVID mask.
It seemed a lot to ask.
To wear a mask.
To do a simple task.
Put on a mask.
I need a COVID mask. Made it mandatory almost every place that we can't be seen unless we hide our face. I can't even leave my humble abode without something covering my mouth and nose.
We need a mask.
We need a COVID mask.
A COVID mask.
It seems a lot to ask.
To wear a mask.
Can't even mow my grass.
Without a mask.
Without a COVID mask. This mask wearing isn't fun. And the snitching has now begun. My neighbor called the hotline, 'cause my dog wasn't wearing one. Walking through the mall, a woman's voice did ring. Seems she was troubled by just one thing. She pointed to the door, shook her fist and said,
"What are you trying to do, you jerk? Make everybody sick?"
Forgot his mask.
Forgot my COVID mask.
His COVID mask.
Nobody gets a pass.
That stupid mask.
Can't even pump my gas.
Without a mask.
Without a COVID mask. Honey, I'm home.
What do you want?
I need to come in and get my mask.
You're not daddy in the house, Mommy. He's been wearing his mask.
No mask, no entry. Sorry.
But honey,
you should have taken it with you. You're not getting in this house. I changed the lock.
Seems she was troubled by just one thing. She pointed to the door, shook her fist and said,
"What are you trying to do, you jerk? Make everybody sick?"
Forgot his mask.
Forgot my COVID mask.
His COVID mask.
Nobody gets a pass.
That stupid mask.
Can't even pump my gas.
Without a mask.
Without a COVID mask. Honey, I'm home.
What do you want?
I need to come in and get my mask.
You're not daddy in the house, Mommy. He's
still
wearing his mask.
No mask, no entry. Sorry.
Yeah.
But honey,
you should have taken it with you. You're not getting in this house. I changed the lock.
Oscar Nowak. I got the other video. Sorry, I a little bit extra for those of you watching on Facebook or Periscope or Twitch. Are we on Twitch? I don't even know if we're on Twitch or not. I tried. I don't know if I got it working or not. Anyway, the COVID mask. I will post the video on my blog at NicoleSandler.com/8-7-20. That's where I'll post today's show because it's really good. And this guy, Oscar Nowak, this is the only thing he's got on his YouTube channel, but everyone should subscribe anyway because it's that good. It was really good, right? Good. So that's the first time you've seen me chair dancing. Yeah, because I usually have a video playing when these songs are playing. Anyway, let's get to some news, shall we? Before the Meiselas brothers come.
I read the news today.
Oh, boy. All right. Where to even begin? Because there's a lot going on today. And let's see what time I got to get out of here. Oh, we don't have much time today. All right. So let me tell you what's happening. The Bureau of Labor Statistics this morning released their July jobs report. And the U.S. economy added 1.8 million jobs, bringing the unemployment rate down to 10.2%. And of course, Donald Trump tweeted out something to the effect of, "Look at those great job numbers." Keep in mind that more than 30 million Americans remain unemployed. The unemployment rate is still over 10%. And Congress is getting nowhere on this new coronavirus relief package. So a three-hour meeting last night ended with without resolving any of the major differences, but they met again today. And after over three more hours of talks in Nancy Pelosi's office, where she says Mark Meadows banged on the table and he denies it, they're still reportedly miles apart. Here's what Nancy Pelosi had to say after that meeting fell apart.
We had what I would call a consequential meeting.
Consequential.
It was one where we could see the difference in values that we bring to the table. We have always said that the Republicans and the president do not understand the gravity of the situation, and every time we meet with them, it is reinforced. We want to reach an agreement for the American people, for our children and their education, for everyone and their health care, for our workers, for our economy. It's so clear that we should do something, and we should do something big.
You think?
And we should do it in a way that is bipartisan, as we have done every other bill.
Right.
I couldn't help but thinking when we were at the table that what they were offering us was Sophie's choice.
Hmm.
Not enough money for food, nothing for housing in terms of rentals. A moratorium, that's nice, but it's not money for rent. Not enough money in the pockets of the American people who really need this, who through no fault of their own are out of work. And certainly, when they said a skinny proposal, it was anorexic.
Anorexic.
And it was not to meet the needs of the American people. What is a negotiation about? It's not about who gets more what in the halls of Congress. It's about what it translates into the lives of the American people. And that's why I kept asking, why won't you do this? Why won't you do this? Why won't you do this? But nonetheless, we've had some further exchange of paper to be clarified to see if we can find some further common ground. But we're very far apart. It's most unfortunate.
It's most unfortunate. They're very far apart. Meanwhile, here we are. More than 19 million cases of coronavirus have now been recorded worldwide. The U.S. is closing in on 5 million cases. And a new model predicts our death toll here in the States could reach nearly 300,000 by December. It's now at about 160,000. By the way, one of the reporters today asked the orange idiot to clarify what he meant when he was confronted with these death numbers, and he said, it is what it is. What did that mean?
It should have been sent to us. It came from China.
Nobody can do what I did, he goes on, and I'm not going to play it for you, but he basically bragged that he's done a great job. Really? And blamed it on China again. So that's what he's doing. Not negotiating, not doing anything but trying to blame everyone else and saying, I'm doing a great job. No, you're actually not.
Bullshit.
Yeah. Now, yesterday, I was telling you about, you know, all the subpoenas issued for Deutsche Bank and the juxtaposition of the big announcement from New York's Attorney General Letitia James yesterday. Well, we got to it yesterday afternoon, where New York's Attorney General, Tish James, as she's known to her friends, announced that she has filed a lawsuit alleging that the National Rifle Association is fraught with fraud and abuse. And she's now seeking to dissolve the organization in its entirety for years of self-dealing and illegal conduct. This is just too good. She described Executive Vice President Wayne LaPierre as the central figure, accusing him and three others of breaking numerous laws, leading to the loss of $64 million over 3 years. And it's not just that the NRA lost that money. It's that they took it for their own personal use, paid for their vacations, paid for LaPierre's niece's vacation. I mean, millions of dollars. It's insane. One other thing. We told you yesterday, you know, Trump went to Ohio yesterday ostensibly to tour a Whirlpool plant and talk about energy. And as he planned, well, he was supposed to meet with Ohio's governor, Mike DeWine, on the tarmac, but DeWine tested positive for the coronavirus. Well, after, so he didn't meet with Trump. He went and had another test that came back negative. So he'll allegedly undergo a third test this week. Apparently, those very safe, those fast tests that they use around Trump are not very accurate. So, you know, as they've gotten maybe a false positive here and there, perhaps they've gotten a false negative too. Watch out, Donnie. Germs. Now, although DeWine didn't join Trump on the tarmac at the airport, Trump still managed to make news. This was presented as an official White House visit where policy is discussed. But Trump again broke the rules to be hyper-political. And as usual, he just makes shit up. And he does it, so we expect it. But this time, it was a step over the line even for this orange blowhard.
He's following the radical left agenda. Take away your guns, destroy your Second Amendment, no religion, no anything, hurt the Bible, hurt God. He's against God, he's against guns, he's against energy, our kind of energy. I don't think he's going to do too well in Ohio.
Yeah, you don't think he's going to do too well? You know what I need to start doing? I need to have a laugh track. I'm looking to see if I have any laughter loaded in my, I don't think I do, in my little wallow sound here. But what I will do is get some handy for next week. Because, you know, like Bill Maher uses a laugh track now. I'll tell you, last week, the laugh track wasn't even laughing. That's how not funny Bill Maher has gotten. But Donald Trump, if we stop getting frustrated by him and just laugh at the crap that comes out of his mouth, it might help us survive the next few months. I don't know. It's a thought. Anyway. All right. Well, let's get to it. I've been promoting the fact that the three brothers behind MeidasTouch would be joining us. And I don't want to wait any longer. So let's just get to it. Shall we? All right. Take it away. Me. Let's get him on the line. I'm thrilled to welcome three brothers to the show. Ben, Brett, and Jordan. Meiselas? How do I pronounce your name, gentlemen?
Meiselas, and thanks for having us on the show.
Meiselas, and thank you for coming. I you know, you're more commonly known to viewers on the interwebs as MeidasTouch. So obviously, Meiselas, Meidas, it's a play on your name, yes?
It is a play on our name, and it's funny to hear that we're more commonly known by MeidasTouch, given that this began as a quarantine hobby and has obviously become something much bigger.
Wow. So this did. Okay, so let's start. You got three guys are brothers. One of you is an attorney. Who's the lawyer?
Can you guess which one's the attorney, Nicole, from the footage?
Well, that would be you, Ben, right? And the one who comes out in front and speaks the most, like takes the lead. That's Ben?
That's right. So, yeah, I'm a civil rights attorney. Brett's an editor, and Jordan's a marketing supervisor.
And two of you are on the West Coast. Two of you are in California, and one of you is back east and in where, D.C. or New York?
New York.
Got it. And so during the quarantine, you decided to pull your resources and your talents and have some fun and make videos. How did this all come about?
Well, we started watching these Trump press conferences every day. You know, the country was in a disastrous position. That disastrous nature of everything that was going on was kind of normalized when you're so busy and you're out there working. You just kind of accepted that things were horrible. But being, you know, home in the quarantine, seeing the death count rise every day, seeing the economy triple, and then watching Trump just lie every day in these press conferences was so, you know, just deeply distressing. And we all thought we have to do something. We didn't necessarily know what that something was. So we began just pooling our talents and created a blog and just started writing about how we felt. And that led to a political action committee. But we started off just writing news and blogging and doing interviews and just writing our feelings.
Wow. Now, Brett is the editor. Brett, you do video editing and producing, so you were all ready to go and start just jumping in to produce some fun things that could grab attention on the internet?
I was ready to go, but I never in a million years thought it would happen this organically, where we'd be putting this kind of content out. I mean, I had never produced a political video ever.
Wow.
So I had worked on a daily talk show. I had worked in movies. I had cut some trailers and things like that, but never anything with a political base. But I think that's almost helped us because the three of us all are outsiders from the political sphere. So we come in and we get to approach it and we get to look at politics different than someone who's been in DC for 50 years. You know, we're coming at it with fresh eyes and we're coming out with the passion of just three brothers who are just upset about what's going on in the country. And in fact, I think it's not funny, it's sad to highlight. I found this morning, and I'm pulling it up now, I tweeted on February 28th about coronavirus and about the pandemic that was about to hit. And Trump had just complained that the stock market crashed and that it was the Democrats' fault or something. And I responded to him, I said, coronavirus is about to hit our shores and you're concerned about the stock market. Mm-hmm. Like, let's get real. Let's focus. Like, we're in danger here. And never in a million years could I imagine that on February 28th, when I sent that tweet, that we would still, that not only would we still be dealing with the crisis, that the crisis we were witnessing overseas would have hit our shores in this way, would have been handled so poorly. And now it's August. Yeah. And it's still going on, and there's still no plan, there's no leadership, there's no national testing strategy, there's nothing. It's just, he's rudderless, and he's still making the same complaints and excuses, and it's just crazy to me that, and it shows, you know, behind the passion of the three of us, that we were talking about this stuff just being concerned citizens months and months and months ago. So why wasn't the president of the United States, who has access to all the intelligence in the world, why wasn't he paying attention and doing what needed to be done?
Because he's Donald Trump. I mean, I think that was more of a rhetorical question because there really isn't an answer for it. Now, the other thing that I've that I'm impressed with, and one of the other reasons why I wanted to talk to you guys is because you are lifelong progressives. You never did. You hadn't produced videos, you hadn't stepped into the political realm, but you are progressives. It's not like you're, like some other people, never Trump or Republicans who just want to see him out of office, but then want to promote a Republican agenda. You guys are progressives. Have you been involved politically, even if you didn't, produce videos before this?
So me somewhat. I went to school in George Washington University.
That's
and
bad.
I interviewed on the Hill for Congressman Steve Israel, who was the head of the DCCC at the time. And so I worked for him, and then I worked for Hillary Clinton when she was a senator, and she was Senator Clinton, and just kind of loved and every moment of that experience. So that's
Ben was in, and Ben was an intern when he said he was working for her. You were an intern for a semester or two?
Yeah, I was an intern for a semester.
That works.
And, my job was I would, answer constituent mail.
Mm-hmm.
I would I'd get flowers from Grand Central Station and I'd bring the sunflowers into the office and I would grab the speeches whenever she was going to give a speech and I would run it to Uma Abedin and make sure the speech arrived on the Senate floor at the time. So those are my three major tasks. But, you work your way up from the mailroom and it was a great experience.
Absolutely. And now you're a lawyer. And did I read correctly that you're one of the lawyers who represented Colin Kaepernick?
I am. I've been fortunate to, I was Colin's lead lawyer in his case against the NFL. My background before then is in my civil rights litigation. I did a lot of cases where I represent victims and the families of victims and police brutality. And so I exposed a lot of police corruption out here in California and in other states. That's how I met Colin, who picked me as his lead lawyer in the case against the NFL. And then since then, I've worked with Colin and still work with Colin today on all projects. He's one of my closest friends and a true inspiration.
Oh, wow. He's got to be feeling at least heartened, if that's the right word, but seeing the reaction, the response after the final straw, which is how I consider George Floyd's killing. That was the final straw. And people are now going, oh, even people who didn't get it before are now going, that's what the kneeling was about.
Yeah, it's a deep awakening, but a deep awakening to a sad state of the country, that it's real, that racism and systemic racism is incredible problem that's plagued our country and continues to plague our country today. So the vindication is, you know, is appreciated in the sense of you were right, but at the same time, what you were right about is the sad state of the country, which really is a recognition that we need to get to work. We need to fix these problems.
Absolutely. Now, we've been speaking with the Meiselas brothers, Ben, Brett, and Jordan. And one thing we haven't done yet is played any of your videos. And I have a bunch of them pulled here. So we can share some of your talent, some of your productions here. Is there one? Do you guys have a favorite? I can't guarantee that I have it pulled, but I'm wondering if any of you have a favorite.
Oh man, we have produced probably somewhere around 80 videos in the last 3 to 4 months. So picking one, it's like picking one of your favorite kids.
I got you.
What do you guys think? I mean, the snake is always
that one of the snake, which is people really like the snake. The snake came out. It was super cinematic. It was one of the first videos we did. Uses Trump's speech about how a lady lets a snake into her home and the lady wants to rehabilitate the snake, but when the snake gets better, the snake bites her and kills her. And he goes, "Why, snake? Why'd you do this?" And he goes, "You should have recognized I was a snake before you let me in."
Right.
So then Donald Trump has been the snake and we let him destroy our nation. And so that was one of the early ones. But I really like Bye Ivanka.
By Ivanka. You know what? I have the By Don Jr. one queued up.
Which is classic.
That is classic. So I'll tell you, let's play that one. So
I love that one of our most popular, by the way.
Is it? By Don Jr. Because, you know, you're using his own words to just turn it back on him. Right? So let's not wait any longer. This is the Meidas Touch with their ad called By Don Jr. Here we go.
The guy doesn't know what he's doing. It's gross negligence, and honestly, it's worse. It's just sheer incompetence.
I think we're going to be very good with the coronavirus. I think that at some point, that's going to sort of just disappear, I hope.
The nation's death toll now tops 135,000.
There's no enthusiasm. He can't get people to show up or rally. They don't want him on the stump. Honestly, they don't even want him on a teleprompter because he can't even get that right.
They delivered a swift and sweeping, you know, that sweeping.
An anomalous.
This guy is the epitome of the swamp.
President Trump's pardons. Most are white-collar criminals with personal or financial ties to the president.
Whether it's the brother, whether it's the sister, the entire family has enriched themselves.
The Chinese government awarded Ivanka 7 new trademarks.
They can say one thing, do the other, and never get called on it. It's asinine.
Enough hypocrisy.
Meidas Touch is responsible for the content of this advertising.
And at the end, it says hashtag by Don Jr. That was brilliant. And again, it was Don Jr. saying all these things about Joe Biden. But it's the old adage from, I'm sure, when you were kids, too. I'm rubber, you're glue. Everything you say bounces off me and sticks to you. That's the only thing I think of when I hear stuff like that.
Well, what Donald Trump has been able to do.
Why is he speaking anyway? I mean, it's just like, who is this person? I mean, why is he talking? Why is he out there? And the things he says are just so hateful and horrible and divisive and just stupid. So, yeah, we're capturing Don Jr.'s message, but the overall message, too, is like this whole crew of grifters just needs to go away. Like, who is this crew? Like, it's just some weird stuff. Horrible stuff.
It's a weird crew of people. And weren't they supposed to separate themselves? Weren't they supposed to be running the business? What happened to that? I mean, they're as involved in politics as you can get, and they're out on the campaign trail. Their girlfriends are being paid, or wives are being paid by the campaign. It's the biggest grifting operation on the planet.
It is. You know, I saw something the other day. There was a news story about how in the last year, while they were in the White House, what's his name? Jared and Ivanka made like $30 million each. And
And by the way, that was on the low end. That was the low end of the scale. It was like $34 to $179 million on the high end.
Unbelievable.
Which, how can you work in the White House, in the people's house, and be making that kind of money? I mean, come on.
And then go on the news and make those baseless claims. I mean, it's something that we always talk about, you know, with the three of us. It's all projection from that side. And it is just truly bizarre. And that's why I think our formula just works so well, using their own words and juxtaposing it against real footage of things that are happening that they're doing.
Absolutely. And since you're talking about the grifters in the family, you have one, another video from MeidasTouch called Trump Grifts, You Die. Let's hear that one next. Here it is, MeidasTouch on the Nicole Sandler Show.
As our nation suffers,
this is an attack on our democracy.
And people are sick and dying.
The death toll from COVID-19 has now surpassed 140,000 people.
What are Trump's priorities?
New questions about whether President Trump pressured the UK to move the famed British Open to his resort in Scotland.
President Trump is pitching a new location for next G7 summit, his own golf resort.
Prompting new criticism that the president is using his office to enrich himself.
My people wanted it. I don't want to make money.
Online records show the Chinese government awarded Ivanka Trump's brand 7 new trademarks.
Go buy Ivanka's stuff. Give a free commercial here. Go buy it today.
The Trump family is so used to promoting their own brand illegally that they don't see the line there about promoting a different brand.
My pillow. Boy, do you sell those pillows.
The president's daughter seemingly endorsed Goya beans on Twitter.
This is what a self-proclaimed wartime president looks like.
You tell me how a president in the middle of a pandemic has got time for this. Are you kidding me?
Trump grifts, you die.
Another one from the MeidasTouch. So those videos obviously are taking over the internet. They're going viral, as they should. I love when I see a new one in the morning and share it out there. How are you getting these? Are they airing on television or are they internet only ads? What is the marketing plan here? Maybe I should ask Jordan, because you're the marketing guy, right?
No, I am the marketing guy. But it's really an all three brother effort here to figure out what goes where. We do have a few of these spots that are actually running on TV. Some that were running in Montana, Alaska, and Texas.
Nice.
One that's running nationally at this point. And really with that, none of this, let me just say, would be possible without the help of the entire Meidas Mighty, is what we call our followers. And we're just so thankful for them and their continued effort, one, to help fund us through the Act Blue and just really get our message across to the masses. Because, you know, we can make these videos, but if we're only posting them on social, we're only talking in our echo chamber.
Right.
So we need to get these out on TV, on Fox News, and get them seen by the masses.
Absolutely.
That's why it's been so... I was going to say, it's been so great to be able to get these on national TV now. And we're doing these six-figure ad buys, which, I mean, you know, three, 4 months ago, we were three brothers angrily texting each other into our phones. And now we have our ads running on national TV. And the response has been incredible. Even yesterday, we got a tweet from somebody. And these are the coolest ones to me personally. We got somebody that said, I live in a red state. I'm wearing your MeidasTouch shirt. All the young people in the store that I was walking in were pointing at my shirt and giving me thumbs ups. And the old people were giving me quizzical looks. but the young people were all like, yes, that's it. That's it. So, I mean, I think it's cool that finally progressives, especially in these deep red states who've never had a voice before, at least are finding that passion in us and are seeing that. You know, it's cool to be progressive. Like, and as Jordan could say in our slogan, why don't you drop our new slogan?
Yeah. Well, let me just build on that real quick. Because you're thinking something so fundamental to our ethos that I really just want to talk about. And just the notion of that in 2020, Democrats are built different. We just are. In 2016, personally, what I took issue with was every time that they went low, we, the Democrats, went high. The lower they went, the higher road we took. And that just fundamentally doesn't work. It doesn't. Only because when we do that, we come off as elitist. We do. And that's just the thing at the end of the day. So in 2020, progressives punch back. You know, we'll meet you on your home turf. We'll play the game that you want to play, but we're going to play it better, smarter, more strategically, and more aggressively. And we're not just going to win on the social media platforms. No, we're going to win in the election. And it's going to take every single one of us.
And here's the thing, and I'll piggyback off what Jordan says, because, you know, I don't think it's going low. I think it's telling the truth. And the truth is a sad reality of what's going on. And so it might be provocative to hear the truth laid out in such a simple way. and to have it be presented in these 30-second, 60-second clips. But everything we're delivering is the truth. And Trump is just, and his administration and his family, for that matter, are just so horrific that you know, it's just a devastating picture that you're painting.
Absolutely. And where are your parents on all this? Are they still around? And if so, are they must be cavelling.
Yeah, that would be the word they would use.
They're definitely excited. They're both lawyers as well, and they're very excited, and they wear their Meidas Touch gear with pride.
Awesome. Well, people can get Meidas Gear Touch at the website, Meidas, M-E-I-D-A-S, touch.com. It's where you can also chip in to help get these spots aired more on television, where it won't only be preaching to the choir. One of my favorite ones that you just put up recently goes back to something that happened 2 weeks ago. I went off on this the other day on the show. 2 weeks ago on Sunday, Trump sat for an interview with Chris Wallace on Fox. And Chris Wallace said, why in God's name would you ever try to do away with the health insurance plan for millions of Americans in the middle of a global pandemic? And he did his typical, well, we can have a new plan. It's better. It's better. And they're going to have it in 2 weeks. And it'll be done in 2 weeks and it'll be signed. Better. Replace. Well, 2 weeks was up on Sunday, and we still have no healthcare plan. Not that I ever thought there would be one, but you, Meidas Touch, has a new spot out called Trump Has No Healthcare. Here we go.
When we win on November 8th, we will be able to immediately repeal and replace Obamacare.
My first day in office, I'm going to ask Congress to put a bill on my desk.
I hope we're going to surprise you with a really good plan.
You can end up with great health care for a fraction of the price, and that's going to take place immediately after we go in, okay? Immediately.
On my first day. You're going to be very proud of what we put forth having to do with health care. I know that we're all going to make a deal on health care. That's such an easy one.
Form a really great plan.
You've been in office 3.5 years. You don't have a...
Well, we haven't had... Excuse me. You heard me yesterday. We're signing a health care plan within 2 weeks. A full and complete health care plan.
Trump has no plan. Never has. Never will.
I've been saying this for a long time.
Trump has no plan. I do that from time to time, you know, because this show has a video component, but it's a radio show. So when there's like a copy on the screen that's not read, I provide the voiceover. By the way, if you ever need a female voice, I'd love to lend my talents to your work.
Oh, wow. Thank you. That's a very generous offer. Thank you so much.
You got it. Anytime.
Take you up on that.
Please do.
I mean, when you watch that clip, that's not a marketing genius. That's a con man. I mean, that's a liar. And there's a very distinct difference between the two. I mean, he's been saying that thing. And for the viewers listening, the first clips in that were from early 2016 when he was saying we were going to have a healthcare plan. And then he said, we're going to have a healthcare plan on day one. And then he said, the healthcare plan, it's coming. The healthcare plan's coming in 2 weeks. It's coming in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And
thank you.
It's been, you know, 2 weeks since the Chris Wallace interview. It's been 4.5, 5 years since he started saying it. And the fact is that he doesn't have a plan. I mean, the plan is mass death and mass devastation. That is the plan. And if he wanted to make a healthcare plan, really all he wants to do is he wants to remove Obamacare. He wants to remove the Affordable Care Act and put something out there with his name on it. I mean, he just has such disdain for President Obama. And by the way, happy birthday, President Obama.
Oh, that's right.
We miss you, and we posted a video for you today. With you in it. But yeah, I mean, it's he just has this disdain for Obama, and it's just, that's his policy. Like, that's all he cares about is just taking away things. And if he really cares about pre-existing conditions, then why is he in the Supreme Court right now to remove those pre-existing conditions?
Exactly.
And why do this, especially? It's just especially heinous to do this during a global pandemic where 158,000 people are dead. ICUs are full to capacity. I mean, this is a once in a generation crisis, and he's failed to meet the moment. But beyond that, he's made the moment worse.
Yes. Well, without a doubt, everything out of his mouth is a lie. Also, that's the other thing. I've had this theory actually that goes back longer than Trump of opposite world. You know, it really came to being during the Bush years, but it, oh my God, it works now because, you know, up is down, in is out, red is purple. And aside from the opposite part of it, it's this gaslighting that these people yes. engage in on a constant basis. And we have to keep reminding us the sky is indeed blue. They're going to tell you it's green. They're going to insist it's green. They're going to make you feel crazy when you won't agree with them that it's green, but it's blue. And then they keep telling you it's green. And it's right. We need to keep saying.
And by the way, that's why it's important for voices like you to be speaking out and saying that. And that's why journalists have to do it. And that's why the Chris Wallace interview was so impactful, because he was one of the first people in 4 years to actually say, hey, no, that's not true. And I'm sure you've seen the Axios interview with Swan last night. Yeah. And I think the reason why people are going crazy over it is because finally somebody said that's not true. You can't say that the U.S. has the lowest death rate. We have one of the highest death rates. You can't just make up lies or pull out fake charts. We're going to call you on it. And it's sad that it took 3.5 to 4 years for a journalist to learn how to speak to him. But once he's questioned, he's against the wall. He doesn't know what to say. And there isn't always a both sides. You know, there just isn't. Like, there's not. If you say the sky is blue, the news to me, if you're a truthful news source, you don't have to say, well, some people are saying the sky is blue, but other people are seeing clouds and other people are seeing purple. I mean, look outside. Tell us what it is. That's the truth. That's reporting objectively. Objectively isn't trying to do a balancing act between a corrupt, lying side and the truth.
Exactly right. You're exactly right. You know, and then there's the other part. It's like, you know, he's a con man. You know, he's a crook. You know, he's a blackmailer. And I often wonder, what the hell does he have on Lindsey Graham? Now, we know Lindsey, and we know there's a lot of stuff out there about Lindsey Graham. But, you know, the thing that is unimpeachable are his own words. And sure enough, you guys, MeidasTouch, you took some of Lindsey Graham's own words and you made a video out of it. Here we go.
I want to talk to the Trump supporters for a minute. Donald Trump is a race-baiting, xenophobic, religious bigot.
Very fine people on both sides.
Racist Twitter tirade aimed at four Democratic congresswomen of color.
The Chinese virus.
He doesn't represent my party.
I don't know what I said.
He's a war hero because he was captured. I like people that weren't captured, okay? I hate to tell you.
He doesn't represent the values that the men and women who wear the uniform are fighting for.
So that Navy command relieved of duty after sounding the alarm about a coronavirus outbreak on his aircraft carrier.
The letters shouldn't have been sent.
He's putting our soldiers and diplomats at risk.
Many announces about getting a final confirmation from West Point that he's going to do the West Point graduation in June.
He's going to put people at risk and risk our military readiness.
He's empowering the enemy.
The whole world watching. Would you denounce what happened in 2016?
President Putin was extremely strong and powerful in his denial today.
I think Donald Trump is a political car wreck, and people slow down and look at the wreck, but they eventually move on.
Then I see the disinfectant where it knocks it out in a minute. And is there a way we can do something like that? Injection.
You know how you make America great again? Tell Donald Trump to go to hell.
Patriotism is bipartisan. Vote blue to restore America's values.
We should redraft that one. I was just telling Brett as I resaw it, that'd be a good one to just drop again.
To repost, yeah, because I think that was like one of the second or third videos we ever made as MeidasTouch when people didn't even quite know who we were as a group. And I mean, and the patriot is bipartisan is a good phrase because this isn't about right or left. It's not about Democrat or Republican. We're fighting for the existential future of our country. And that's what people need to realize. And I'm not going to speculate about, you know, what they have on Lindsey Graham, I mean, whatever it is. It must be pretty bad. I'm not going to speculate on exactly what it is. But I'll say it seemed like Senator McCain and his relationship seemed to keep him grounded. And yeah. Senator McCain at least had a moral backbone that allowed him to speak up to the administration. And unfortunately, when we lost Senator McCain, it seemed like Senator Graham kind of went off the deep end and kind of just committed to the dark side. And that's really one of the most upsetting things to me about the age of Trump is just that, you know, my whole life, I grew up, you know, learning in civics classes and history and everything, that we have three branches of government and that no branch of government could ever do anything all that bad because the other branches of government are there to check them.
Yeah, checks and balances.
Of course, they're to check them. And the checks and balances. And even during Nixon, you know, there were checks and balances. Now we have a Republican Party who enables him at every step. And it's sad because, first of all, this guy isn't even a conservative. I mean, even if you are a conservative and consider yourself to have conservative values, the deficit's at an all-time high, our debt's at an all-time high, our spending is through the roof. He's sending, he's being like a fascist dictator by sending yep. unarmed federal troops into our cities. I mean, there's no more big government than what Trump is doing, and none of it to help the public, but all to control and show power over the public. And you'd think somebody would stand up. You'd think there'd be somebody besides Romney who right. would stand up and say, this is wrong. Romney, by the way, who was their nominee only a few years ago. Mm-hmm. I mean, let's not forget. It's just a sad, I mean, it's sad. It's tragic. And the thing that you know is that if and when Trump loses on November 3rd, you know, these people are going to turn on him so quickly and they're going to try to distance from him so quickly after he starts complaining about the election results and once they get past that. But I mean, there are already reports that they're starting to tell people running that, hey, you could start distancing from this guy if you want. We won't hold it against you. I mean, people know this guy's toxic. It's just don't be pathetic. Don't be don't embarrass the country. Speak out.
That's a slogan, I mean, for you. Anybody who wants it, don't be pathetic.
If you want to win, if you want to have the respect, like show some backbone. Yeah. Show some backbone. And I think that's why Joe Biden is gaining traction in states like Texas and Alaska mm-hmm. and North Carolina and Georgia. It's because at the end of the day, people might have thought Trump was that guy in 2016, that he was the guy who was telling the truth and telling it how it is. I don't think anybody aside from the Kool-Aid drinking, you know, Trump cultists at the end of the day right now truly could look at that Axios interview, for example, and say this is a normal human being who even tells a story that resembles the truth. I mean, we got to call him out and we got to get him out.
Exactly. So we're under 3 months away from the election. Again, we're speaking with the Meiselas brothers, Ben, Brett, and Jordan, who collectively are MeidasTouch, who've been making these wonderful videos, these anti-Trump videos that are entertaining, they're humorous, and they have an important message and that people are sharing because they're so good. So thank you so much for doing this. And do you have plans for after November 4th and what you're going to do next?
So right now our focus is we got to get this guy out of office. And would we like to make sure that this is a progressive force for the future? Sure. But the immediate short-term goal is what can we do every day? We're 91 days until the election.
Yeah.
Count those days down every day. And what we ask our supporters to do is, what have you done with each one of those 91 days? Jordy, at the beginning of each day, kind of tweets out a message that's basically like, what are you doing today? And that's what we tell everyone. If you're a comedian, if you're an artist, if you're an accountant, if you're a lawyer, if you're a radio host, if you're a teacher, if you're an artist, if whatever your job is, I could list every job in the world. It doesn't matter. If you're furloughed, if there's no job, if you have a hobby, use the hobby, use the talent, and do something with it. And don't just sit there and be helpless or hopeless. We felt that way for some time, you know, for many years, until we just said, how do we put our talents together? And we created this incredible thing called MeidasTouch, which is now having a direct impact on the election. I promise you, If we can do it, you can do it. The only formula is passion.
That's awesome. All right. Well, let's spread the word. My listeners, I know, I put the videos out all the time. We'll step it up as well, because your stuff is great and people need to see them. And it, like I said, it informs and entertains, which is the perfect meeting of the minds. That's what you need to do. Again, Ben Meiselas, Brett Meiselas, Jordan Meiselas, you guys are great. I love that you're working together and doing this. It just makes the package so much better. We'll leave with one more ad. I've got a few more here. So you choose. Should we do the unprecedented idiot? Nobody likes Trump, or evict Trump from the White House?
I think nobody likes Trump. I would say I'm president and idiot, but that one's a little more visual. And I think as far as the listeners are concerned, I think the other one would be a little better.
Great. And you guys, my offer stands. I do voiceover work. I've got a home studio. If you need a female voice for anything, shoot me over a script. I'll record it and send it back to you. I'd love to participate and help you out any way I can. That's the best way I can.
We'll be taking you up on that. Thank you so much. And to add on what Ben said is, you know, the donations are great and they allow us to go on to TV, but we take an hour of anyone's time over a dollar and any day of the week. So just please get out there, do what you can to sign people up to vote, phone bank, use your skills and make it happen. 91 days. It's really not a lot of time. We need to be full force, because our country's at stake.
You got that right. That's Brett. You guys are great. It was so nice to meet you. I hope we can do it again. And we'll sign off with Nobody Likes Trump. All right. Take it away, guys.
Thanks for having us.
Why don't I have a high approval rating?
More than 150,000 people have died of the coronavirus in the U.S.
The U.S. leading the world in deaths.
Why don't I have a high approval rating?
Half of the U.S. population is without a job.
Why don't I have a high approval rating?
Allegations that Vladimir Putin put a price on the lives of American soldiers in Afghanistan.
You had a phone call with Vladimir Putin on July 23rd. Did you bring up this issue?
No, that was a phone call to discuss other things.
And you've never discussed it with him.
I have never discussed it with him. Why don't I have a high approval rating? Nobody likes me. It can only be my personality. That's all.
I'm thrilled to welcome.
Yeah. Nobody likes Trump. And how much do we love the Meiselas brothers? I told you yesterday, I think I said, because David gave me grief over it, I said they're adorable. I can get away with that because I'm an old lady now. But they're, you know, they're three cool brothers. They've got to be in their 30s. I hope you saw the video. I will post the entire video, since we're not on YouTube now, and in case you didn't get to see it on Facebook Live or Periscope, I'll post it on the blog at NicoleSandler.com, where I post the audio podcast, so you can see these videos as well and see how cute the brothers are. And I loved when I asked about their parents and whether they're kvelling, which is a Yiddish word, and they got it. They said that's exactly the word they'd use. Very, very cool. They're just impressive, and that's what it's all about. I love the fact that people are getting so creative, and you know that because I've been finding these videos online, doing the parody videos like the COVID mask we played today, which will also be posted on the blog because it's that funny, that good. This is people making lemonade out of lemons, taking the time we're stuck at home to get creative and use it for the greater good. So these brothers, again, two of them are in L.A., one of them is in New York, but they are working together and collaborating and making a difference, right? And so, I don't know, I feel better about touting the work of three young Democrats who've always been Democrats rather than the Lincoln Project, who, again, are doing good work, but, you know, they're going to go back to being Republicans as soon as they possibly can. They don't have the same goals we have. It's part of my problem with MSNBC these days, too. You know, they extended Nicole Wallace's show. And I got to say, she's better than I thought she'd be. But she's still a Republican. And she still has Steve Schmidt on all the time. And you got to remember, those two people, Nicole Wallace and Steve Schmidt, or it should be Steve Schmidt and Nicole Wallace, ran the John McCain campaign and brought in Sarah Palin to be his running mate. Right there, that should question their stability and judgment and just make you wonder, you know, did they have our best interests in mind? Just saying. All right, with that, my mind is moving too quickly. It's a good thing it's Friday and we are at the end of the show. I will be back Monday. I'm not quite sure what we're doing yet on Monday, but we've got Thomas Frank coming up next week and a bunch of good stuff. So, yeah, have a wonderful weekend, everyone. Wear your masks and be safe. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next week.